Welcome to We're Not Wizards. We are the best, but not wizards. Enjoy the show!
Welcome to another episode of We're Not Wizards. My name's Richard. I'll be your host for July. And it's been a mixture of rain. And it's also been a mixture of, like, lots of sun. So it's either been rainy or it's been sunny. Which is fine. Which I can kind of deal with. It does mean that I'm having to cut the grass in the garden an awful lot more. So it's kind of terrible kind of that way. I'm kind of, I don't know, it's kind of like first world problems, I guess. Because, I mean, if this was, like, say, a couple of hundred years ago, I wouldn't be worrying about the grass. I'd be just, like, grateful of getting a little bit of rain and getting a little bit of sun. You could probably say I'd be out there, potentially be out there kind of trying to find new things. I'd be potentially out there kind of prospecting. Now, it wouldn't be an old prospect. It'd probably be a new prospect. And if you're going to be talking about new prospects, then you have to talk about a board game. And the board game you're going to have to talk about is Coloma, the expansion, New Prospects. And joining me to talk about Coloma, the prospects, the expansion and the reprint, I've got the wonderful, the fantastic, the amazing, very, very busy, JonnyPac. Hey, Jonny.
Hey, thanks for having me on. That was a good segue intro. I hope that was improvised because that was amazing.
It's the only thing that I'm good at. Everything else is going to come crashing to the ground. Like some kind of burning spitfire, basically. The campaign's doing quite well. I mean, now I'm going to say the American version because we do have listeners in America. It's June 13th. But for all you civilized people out there, it's currently the 13th of June. And there's about 6 days left and you're almost at, well, you're like 600 odd percent kind of funded. So you're almost at the $200,000 mark. So you must be, well, how is Mood in Camp at the moment?
It's pretty good. Just when I was going to bed at the wee hours last night, I was working on some game stuff. I saw that we passed 2,000 backers, which is nice because sometimes, of course, the, you know, X amount percent on Kickstarters or GameFound is a little misleading because you don't actually know what the funding goal was, and sometimes they're set very low, yeah, whatever else. But when you see a lot of backers and you just know that there's actual people that have that thing in their cart and are excited to get it, and that means a lot to me. So I'm excited to see that there's 2,000 people out there have pledged already and more coming along, and that's exciting to me just to think about it on all those tables when it comes out.
Now, Coloma itself has been kicking around kind of for some time. In fact, before we started recording, it was 2019, and so it's now 4 years ago, which when you think 2019, I always think, well, that's just a year ago or something like that, but it's now like 4 years ago, which just goes to show that time goes far too fast. And I was basically stuck, not halfway up a hill, but I was in some kind of hill-like retreat in November, at the end of November, and one of the games that we played was Coloma, and the person I played it with was Mike Dilisio, and Mike Dilisio, as you know, he's part of the Dice Tower, and so he said it was one of his favourite games, and we played it, and I played about with the magnet disc thing and annoyed him quite a bit because I kept on kind of spilling all his components. And I think out of three people, I managed to come fifth. So it was a good game, and everybody had a kind of a good fun time. In terms of the expansion kind of thing, was that Was that something that was you've been planning for some time and it was just a case of finding the right time? Because one thing that's obvious in the middle of this is between 2019 and today, there was a little bit of a cough and a cold going about in the pandemic, which I think kind of stopped a lot of kind of like development time and stuff like that. So is that what happened with the expansion, or is the expansion just taking a little time to kind of get out there?
It's something I've wanted to do kind of all along. So ultimately the game went out of print pretty quickly after it first came out, and that's due to pandemic times and things like that. And part of it was a sentiment that Coloma is especially good in a lot of people's opinion, higher player counts. It's one of those few like medium heavy Euro games that plays all the way up to six players naturally, and it doesn't completely bog down at six. And so, that said, though, during the pandemic times, it wasn't likely that six people were cooped up in the same cabin that often. And so games seem to go solo-centric, two-player-centric, and board games are selling very well. And so were puzzles and activities and things like that for people that were kind of, you know, homebound. But Coloma felt like a kind of a risky product for them to re-release right away in the midst of all that, and also trying to... galvanize people to, you know, get together and play it. So they kind of sat on it for a little bit, and then we kept kind of like getting the temperature on, hey, is it time to do this? Is it time to do that? And they finally reached out and said, hey, you know, we think things are opening up, the world's ready for this, let's bring it back. And are you ready for that expansion? And all along I'd just been kicking ideas around the back of my head, just not knowing whether or not they'd get implemented. And so, to be honest, I, you know, really started working on the expansion very like early this year, as far as actually building prototypes, testing it and all that. So it's pretty fresh stuff. And though that might sound kind of rushed in one sense, it's actually not, because there's just so many things that I want to do with the game. And I also had a kind of a rich source of inspiration coming from its predecessor game, which was a little, you know, vanity print run of a game that turned into Coloma eventually, which was more complex, and I had stripped out some of the mechanisms to make Coloma the streamlined power hour game that it can be. And I was able to go back, like, all right, well, there's a little bit more headroom for complexity. People who know the game are willing to add new stuff into it and not feel totally overwhelmed, whereas if all this stuff was baked into the core game, onboarding would be a little bit trickier. So it gave me more design space, and I was like, okay, let me go crazy and see what I can do. And then all this time has given me the opportunity to read feedback from BGG and reviewers and people, critics, and see, are there some weak spots in Coloma that the expansion can patch in and create some better experiences or reach a wider audience? And notably, the booming and busting mechanism is so core to the game, but some people were turned off by the fact they would say, oh, I busted 12 out of 15 turns in the game, and there's no coming back from that. Led me to think, what could we do to like maybe put a new spin on that? And that's one of the main factors of the expansion, is how it addresses the boom bust mechanism.
So did you have, it sounds to me like you had, it was almost like you had, you put everything together into Coloma, but you, like most kind of game designs, is that game design to me seems to revolve around taking 100 ideas, putting them all together, and then kind of cutting away 78 of those ideas and running with the 20 or so that you've got left. And so am I right in saying that you kind of had stuff on the side already that you'd probably been playtesting a little bit, and then bringing it in wasn't as difficult as maybe kind of starting completely from scratch? Because one of the things I find in expansions is games get really, really... Well, expansions come two ways. You either get them as part of a bigger Kickstarter campaign, and they're not necessarily expansions. They are one of the 78 pieces that were just cut off to call them expansions. Or you get, like, the situation where yourself, where people go, this game's great, I really, really like this game, it's lots of fun, it'd be nice if we could have some extra stuff to it. And you're kind of almost starting from scratch, saying, well, what can we add kind of expansion wise? But it sounds to me like you kinda had that kind of there. Was it nice to be kind of working on something that you knew how it worked, how it balanced out and everything like that, and you weren't having to figure things out to kind of make it work.
Yeah, yeah, I do enjoy that. Like, I understand the economy of Coloma pretty well, so there's certain elements, like the gold economy, and it's like one of the, it's not the most stable thing, and if there's a lot of cards that, or effects that pull gold out of the river, all of a sudden that crashes and ends up to a lot of edge cases and stuff. So I know it's like, all right, the gold is very delicate. These other economies are a little bit more robust. So getting in there and figuring that stuff out was, you know, I've kind of got all my baseline math pre-sorted. And as far as the content goes, some of the stuff that is in there, there's some additive stuff where there's new stuff, but there's a lot of stuff that swaps out things wholesale. And that lent me a lot of design space. Like, notably, the biggest one would be that you take all of the player cards from the core game, you just leave them in the box, and you replace them completely with a brand new deck of cards that each player gets. And there's more cards, and the cards are they offer more variety. And so the biggest thing is that the icons on the cards are, effects are triggered by icons instead of site position. So before it's like, when I go to site 4 and if I bust, then I can use this particular card. Now it's more matters whenever I move on the map, there's a little map icon, I get to do this action. So whether I do that through a barrel or through a different like backdoor method, the cards can still fire off. So this creates a lot more interesting chain combos and flexibility that the cards didn't have. And then there's some other mechanisms which I kind of pulled back in that got cut, which was, there was a little bit more worker placement in the original game, which was, as you build cards out in front of you, some of those cards would have worker placement spots in order to do like a powerful action. So it's like, okay, I go put the dudes in the shootout, and then I could put dudes on hotels if you're playing with that module. And then you'd additionally be able to put some dudes on the, what's now these little outhouse cards. And you go in the outhouse and the guy's going to stay there for reasons for the rest of the round, and then let you do this really powerful action. And so that's been kind of baked into it. And another mechanism that I kind of pulled from the predecessor game was that there was cards that would get better over the course of time. So you build the card and you put something on it, and then if you wait, the longer you wait, they get more powerful. And now, similarly but different, you have a little marker on some cards that if you trigger the card now, it's fine, it gives you something. But if you bust, it advances to the right, and if you bust again, it advances some more. And then if you cash it out at that point, it has a bigger payout. So it kind of creates this insurance policy that the longer you wait for these certain cards, the more they pay out. And that creates that reverse incentive that, hey, if I want my cards to all, let's say, mature, then it's okay if I bust a couple times on the wheel, because when I finally do cash in, I'm going to have this big, epic comeback move. And so that's kind of how the cards go. So in a sense, it's like there's not more cards where they're like, now there's 40-something cards to play with. It's like, no, there's 20 cards instead of the 16, I think, in the original. And and they're just slightly more complex, and they do more interesting stuff. But it's not like an overwhelming amount of new content or diluted decks, which sometimes happens with expansions.
Yeah, that is one of the things you want to avoid with an expansion, because I know some people, they clamor out for an expansion, and then when they get the one, they're like, well, this completely changes the game beyond what I enjoyed about the original game. And it kind of sometimes kind of puts it off, or it adds kind of levels of complexity that puts people off from setting it up with the expansions. I know some games I've seen with expansions look extremely daunting, like Anachrony. And I don't know if you've ever seen that kind of set up with all the different kind of expansions and stuff like that, but it's kind of like looks like a Christmas feast or a Thanksgiving feast when you see it on the table, and it's just like, I'm gonna need two plates, to kind of even begin to kind of tackle this kind of entire kind of situation. Stripping it back just a little bit, what in terms of your approach to your design in general, are you, how do you approach it? Are you someone that kind of like looks at a theme and then says, well, mechanically, how can we gamify that? Or are you the type of person that has kind of, you have an idea for a mechanic and you'll have like a kind of a ring binder at the side of the bed that you wake up sleepily at 3 o'clock in the morning and start kind of jotting down ideas in the hope that maybe you can involve it as some kind of game. What's your kind of your process, would you say, Jonny?
So I like to think that I work on thematically informed designs, but I am a mechanics first designer, and I would argue that games are mechanics first, because you can have mechanics with no theme and it's still a game, but you can't really just have a theme and no mechanics and get a game out of it. So in a sense, I think there is going to be a little bit of weight and burden that the mechanics kind of need to set the bedrock of everything else that happens after that, even for, you know, story-driven games and things like that. So what I try to do is come up with a novel mechanism, but not just one that's like, hey, here's a new drafting mechanism. Cool. Mm-hmm. Like, that's not quite enough for me. And then it's like, okay, how about another mechanism that's kind of novel in some way? All right. And then maybe like a third supporting mechanism. And once I get a few mechanisms I think are going to interlock with each other and kind of create interesting feedback loops, I think that that's enough to be compelling. Because in this day and age, I think it's actually really hard to just come up with like a pure single mechanism and just let a game stand on that. Like, okay, here's deck building Dominion. That's just great deck building. You buy cards and you do stuff and you get victory points and you're done. Now it's like, you get the Arnax and the Dunes and the Endless Winters, all these games where it's like, it's deck building and it's worker placement and they've all got a certain spin on them. Right. And so it's like that hybridization is where it becomes interesting. And then thematically, I don't like to go very far on a design until I have a theme that I find compelling, inspiring, and preferably something that's publishable. So in that case, I won't really go too far. It's because I actually think it's harder to come back and just say, hey, let's put a skin on this thing now that it's so complex. This track doesn't make sense with that theme. Oh, well, let's just call it something. Yeah. And everything gets very thematically dissonant. I'd rather have those core mechanisms and then let the theme inform whatever those supporting mechanisms might be. So for instance, like the gold mechanism in Coloma, it's like, well, to me, it makes sense that gold is flooding in the rivers and it comes up and down. The more people have it, the price of it is very volatile based on what's going on. Cause there was times in the gold rush where so many people had so much gold that getting laundry done as a service someplace cost more than just buying the new bridges. And so people stopped getting their, you know, stuff done, and they'd have to come up with like a wheelbarrow of gold just to like get the most basic thing, like breakfast or something. So the economy just at times was extremely inflated and weird. And then there's at times where it was, you know, nothing. It's, you know, you go bust, whatever else. So that volatility was interesting to me, and that led into that mechanism there. And even the idea of like some of the old West saying, it's like, you know, Coloma or bust, you know, so people head out west and they were going to put everything they had into this boom town and try to make it rich there, or risk absolutely getting nothing because somebody else beat you to the spot where it was. And it's kind of this push and pull. And so a lot of things kind of work there. And with the expansion, even like some of the stuff, I you know, live in the Sierras, and one of the things I really love out there is like the rivers. And there's these incredible waterfalls and all these different spots up there. And the rivers in the core game were a little underwhelming. We could just put it that way. It's just like a little tile. It's got a river on it. You put it on your player board and it unlocks something. All the rivers don't actually do anything special. It's just to unlock your player board. And I thought, hey, what if I, you know, expand the size of these things and the rivers, you know, now become waterfall spots and they actually have a unique bonus. And then what if you can actually travel to these little things and create like a little route that allows you to go and experience these rivers and waterfalls in different ways and then unlock some stuff. And those basins around the waterfalls tend to be a place where gold would deposit, or, you know, water was nice and fresh, whatever it is. They're kind of just like these attractive spots. And so I wanted to showcase those a little bit. And one of the little inspirations for that track was from one of my favorite games, Russian Railroads. At the bottom of the Russian Railroads board, you got this little thing where you kind of move your little technology wrench or spanner along this little track and unlock little bonuses. What if we tried something like that with the existing player boards and then these new rivers that are now waterfalls and the bridges that go on top, and then also create some branching paths that you can say, you know, go down here, it's faster, it's a shortcut, but there's a rattlesnake, so you might end up or get dysentery down there. But if you take the long path and you actually survey the river and put the pieces in that spot, you can actually get these big rewards. And so you kind of go at different tempos. And then the driver of that thing is busting again. So it's one of those things where it's not like, hey, I'm going to go place my guy in the work replacement spot that's just going to let me go explore this thing. It's the consolation prize in a sense. So if you build an engine of cards that also benefits from busting, and then you've got your waterfalls plugged in and all this, and you go and you end up busting because you go to the same spot as all the other pioneers, you get to advance everything that's got that criteria. So your waterfall advances, you unlock a bonus, your cards advance, they mature, and you get these big kind of like back end combo turns based on that. So so that, you know, long story short, that the my love of waterfalls and stuff in the Sierras and the Gold Rush era kind of inspired why that whole board is over there and why it is dangerous, because there's rattlesnakes and stuff out there. And it's true. You know, you go out in the rivers and you go swimming, and all of a sudden there's a rattler out there. You're like, ooh, let's take the other trail. So it's all kind of baked into it.
Do you kind of do any kind of historical kind of fact checking then? Because I know it sounds strange, but it's like, if you're kind of doing kind of frontier towns, I think there's enough kind of TV shows and films and books that you can look at to kind of get a general gist. But you also kind of try and do a little bit of checking just to say, well, did this kind of happen? And does it also kind of maybe have an effect on how you kind of handle kind of mechanics and stuff like that as well?
Mm-hmm. Like a real simple one is when the artist came back with the original board for Coloma, he put a bunch of saguaro cactuses on it because it's like old, you know, Western town, bang, bang, shoot them up, and there's cactuses everywhere.
Yeah.
And there are no saguaro cactuses in this part of Northern California. So I said, you know, as cool as that looks, I love cactuses personally. there are no cactuses in Coloma. You gotta have to pay those out. There's other things where he put like Easter egg of like Mark and, the guys from Back to the Future. Marty and Doc are in there. It's like, well, those can stay. That makes sense because it's funny, but no cactuses, right? So there's certain little things like that where I check up on it. And little details, like as far as there's a Native American player character that you can play in there, and the tribe that was most prominent in that area was the Maidu tribe. So I just asked the artist, hey, can you put the headdress of the Maidu garb on this character, just so it didn't look like suddenly there's like, you know, the typical Apache thing or whatever else like that. It's like, yeah, you know, that would just be like phoning it in. So just little details like that. But again, we didn't like get really pedantic about, you know, you can't have Wolverine hidden in the cover of the box cover. Well, in fact, he is in there.
Yeah.
So there's some stuff that's really kind of silly and splashy, and we loosen up the reins on it. And then other things we pay a little more attention to. And then sometimes there's like kind of oddball things that inspire something. So in the expansion, they just actually announced one of the stretch goals is this cable car tram. And it's like, what? So believe it or not, like across the South Fork of the American River, there was this lumber mill on one side of the canyon, and there's a place where they were getting a lot of lumber on the other side. And there's this really, really deep canyon in between. And these crazy pioneers actually just strung cables across the whole thing and had this little tram that would carry logs across, and the cowboys would ride across on this thing. And there's some very old photographs of this thing actually still is in operation into the early 20th century. And it's like, you just see these like cowboys riding logs across this like 800 foot drop into this canyon across this old cable car. It's like, that's crazy. And so I was like, can we put that in the game somehow? And so this expansion is this little module where instead of putting bridges there, you put this little cable car across, and it has a different scoring criteria. So it's like you'll see in the expanded game that you got your bridges, and then this canyon has got this little cables, and there's a little cable car full of lumber and cowboys, you know, dangling out. That normally wouldn't fall into the lexicon of like, hey, let's make a Western game. It's like, and there's going to be cable cars dangling across a canyon.
I can imagine the kind of the BGG comments, kind of people going, this isn't historically accurate. And it's almost like you're going to have to kind of include some kind of pamphlet inside the production copy to say, hey, you, I know you've seen cable cars. I know you're about to go and comment on it. But before you do, here's the picture of what we're kind of talking about. It's almost like you've kind of got to kind of educate it. It's like almost like what Fort Circle games do with their games, like Votes for Women, the shows of Tripoli, where they kind of put an insert into the historical context behind certain, you know, certain mechanics of the game. You're going to have to put up put a pamphlet in New Prospects to say, yeah, you might have noticed a cable car in there, but actually, you know, that kind of did exist. Was game design something you always wanted to do, or was it something you kind of fell into and then kind of went, well, people are giving me money. might as well keep going.
I think I got some cost fallacy about the money part. I'm still just scraping by trying to be a full-time game designer. But historically, I was kind of homeschooled under a rock and didn't get the usual proper education or go to college and stuff. And then I ended up studying private music with a retired Hollywood Union musician who was a composer and arranger that happened to have retired in the small town I grew up in. So I studied music under him and kind of learned a bunch of neat stuff that, you know, you don't always learn in colleges and all that. And then I took that and got into teaching music privately. And since I didn't have, you know, a degree in anything, I was just teaching a lot of private lessons on either music theory or guitar, bass, my preferred instruments, and retail, and guitar shops, record stores, toy stores, that kind of thing. So I was running an art gallery since I was into art and that sort of thing, and doing music and venue stuff. So I was kind of doing like a lot of like artsy music hipster stuff. And I got introduced to Euro games in my 20s. And that was really kind of like the thing that got me into gaming. I didn't have a big background in like RPGs or even video games or Magic or Pokemon or anything. It was kind of like, I just wasn't into that stuff. I was into other things. And somehow Carcassonne and a few of the Euro games sparked my imagination, because I felt like there's kind of a little bit of creativity in it. Like when you build a Carcassonne map, you're actually just building this big beautiful thing, and you're putting little meeples on it, and all the little ornaments, you know, put the pig in this farm and all these other little things. It got me kind of excited. I really enjoyed it. It just felt like a fun activity, and it was also compelling strategically, and it didn't feel as regimented as things like chess and Go, where it's like, you know, there's some, you know, little kid that goes to chess camp every summer, he's just going to whip the pants off you, and you're always, it just didn't have that same kind of thing. It's like, hey, this is relatively new, and you know, now there's Carcassonne champions and all that, but at the time it felt like this is inviting. You can just go in here and play this game, and it's strategic, but there's a little bit of randomness and luck, and it's aesthetically pleasing. And so I started collecting and playing these games, and I did not actually intend to design games. And I built up a collection, hosted game nights, and I was known as the nerd herder, as I'd bring people around to play these Euro games that I would source from like Games at Berkeley and these other places that would import the German style games, and be like, hey, I heard there's this, you know, this Carcassonne or this Puerto Rico or this other game, we gotta try it out. And this Race for the Galaxy, oh my gosh, there's so many icons, can you figure this out? And getting used to that sort of stuff. And it wasn't really until 2012-13 that I took a stab at creating my own game, and that's been 10 years now. So it's been kind of a bumpy ride.
You kind of sound though like you kind of went out, you had a kind of a skinful of alcohol, and then you woke up the next morning and you kind of looked over at the side of the bed and went, oh my goodness, I've just gone ahead and designed a game. Oh my goodness, kind of thing. When you say music, because you can't talk about music and just kind of go, oh yeah, music. Were you a guitarist? Were you a singer? Were you a... You know, what kind of music were you, was it all a mixture of things that you were kind of playing and teaching?
So I studied jazz, improvisation and composition specifically. So it was kind of like a split between, you know, like we're used to hearing about, oh, Ameritrash versus Euro games. It's kind of like this whole like jazz theory versus classical theory. And the truth is, like, we know that there's a lot of hybridization where those things cross over a lot, but I was kind of trained in the jazz standpoint, and I found that it led to a lot of other types of contemporary music that were also partially improv based, which could be like old school country, where it's, you hear all those like fiddle solos and lap steel solos and guitar solos. It's like those are improvised sections, and they had the Nashville number system where there's all these chords being kind of improvised in the studio, and everybody had to be on their A game. And so the idea of structured improvisation a lot of times is just reserved for, oh, it's jazz theory. But it actually leaks into a lot of things, and even a lot of great like psychedelic rock band stuff or jam bands. It's just like there's scales and rules and chords and ways to put stuff together to create fresh music without excessive rehearsal, and each time you play the song, it feels fresh and is enjoyable to play. So I really was fascinated with the kind of the rules that would let you sound good without playing a whole bunch of bad notes with a bunch of other people following similar rules while still having a personal expression, versus the very strict compositional sort of thing with classical, where it's like, all right, we all arrange these things exactly, and you rehearse it, and you perfect it, and you put feeling into it, but you're not really allowed to change the notes or the duration of the notes that much.
Everybody at some time sat down in front of a piano and went, how hard can this be? How, dun, 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 dun. All right, it's that hard. Okay.
Yeah.
But what did you play then?
So primarily guitar and bass. I play the guitar, electric guitar, acoustic guitar, and then the bass. I play the upright bass and the electric bass both, and I switch between them. So a lot of times the stuff I'm doing now, I'll actually have like a rack of bass and guitar nearby each other, and I'll switch between the two if I'm doing solo stuff, because I'll actually loop and play bass lines, and I'll play guitar lines, and I'll put chords down, and then switch between things, kind of like a little one-man band thing, since I don't have a current working band that I'm playing with right now. I would love to start a new band and probably do some like 60s style surf music would be my next endeavor, I think, right now.
Really?
Because that stuff's a ton of fun to play too. Yeah, a lot of instrumental stuff.
So is that like, I mean, everybody talks about kind of like, oh, that's what Ed Sheeran does. He just gets up there and he just has like a guitar loop, and then he has a bass loop, and then he does like a vocal loop and stuff like that. So is that kind of what you're talking about? You kind of record... You record a piece and have it looping, and then you put a second layer on top of it and have the whole thing looping. So you record like the bass line first of all and just have that kind of on a longer loop, and then add the guitar kind of like on top of that. Is that kind of like how you'd be doing it?
Yeah. I've got a little loop station. They've become a lot easier to use and more affordable. So they have, you know, quantizers, little drum machine, whatever, and then you can lay down, whether you play some chords first and add a bass line or whatever else. And typically you can add a track or two and then delete a track or two and kind of build it up and break it down as you go through. And they're not, the stuff I do isn't like highly structured. That's like, I've got this thing where it's like, first I play this lick and then I play that lick and then I look cool for a while and then I play the next lick. And then it's more organic, where I've even done some stuff at shows where I'll ask the audience, say, hey, you pick out a note. Do you know any musical notes? And they'll be like, see? Okay. And what about you? And then, and then they'll always make up some like, E sharp minor. I'm like, well, yeah, okay, we'll do F minor. All right, that works. And then I'll take those notes and I'll kind of like play onto the loop the note that one person says, and I'll play the other one. And even if it's a very like dissonant pairing, whatever else, I can use the rest of music theory to actually like do the spoonful of sugar thing and create stuff that makes sense out of that. And they'll be like, oh my gosh, cool. So it's kind of proves that, you know, it's fresh. And then the other half, it's kind of a fun challenge for me to think about how to take two or three different notes from the audience or chords and merge them together into something that's coherent.
Okay. So question, right? Here's the big question, right? And I want an honest answer from you. Okay. Where's the music game? So, I mean, honestly, you've literally described to me, oh yeah, so you're putting your first level of bass down, and then on top of it, you've got to put kind of like, you've got to then play cards that kind of match with a synergy. And if they don't match, then you get like a worse score. I mean, you sound like you've got some kind of Eurotrack kind of game where you build up kind of different layers of notes, and then you can use your musicality to bring in kind of more instruments. I mean, this is what this is sounding like to me. And there you are, mucking about with a Wild West, Mr. Cantin. What's going on?
So I actually think that a music game is a very, very hard thing to pull off. It's been brought up to me quite a few times. Like, they're out there. It's like, there's a new game coming out called The Gig, and it's got this like cool 1960s aesthetic and this, you know, dice, you know, rolling kind of thing. And then there's games where it's like a battle of the bands kind of thing. I have a friend that's got one that's going to be coming out pretty soon. It's about, you know, kids in the '80s getting all their guitars and equipment together and playing these little dive bars and kind of building up their fan base and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
But I feel like the ones that are actually trying to do something with music, the one missing ingredient that really doesn't work is the fact that just nothing sound doesn't come out of board games naturally. Even a race car game, it's like, even though it's really, really slow and you're just moving around this track with a little car and it's not really like zooming in real time or anything like that, it's still going around the track. It's doing what race cars do.
You make noises. Imagine how many people bought Heat. And I reckon, right, the percentage of people that also kind of like as they're playing Heat were going,
they better
like that at the same time. I reckon that was really, really high. I've got a solution for your problem then. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. QR codes on the cards that you log into an app.
Exactly. So I think that's, if there's going to be a really good like music game, it shouldn't require music theory where it's like, hey, put the treble clef here and put the naturals on sharper flats and then play it and, you know, put it into a MIDI playback. It's like, we can't trust that that's going to work. But what you're talking about makes sense, that if there's something scannable, whether it's QR code or stanza of music or something that you could plug in, and with, you know, like even my basic understanding of music theory, it'd be very easy to actually put things together in a way that will inevitably sound good, even if it were layered. They have certain little tricks and knowing how to do that. So so that could be something where it's, I think, maybe doable with that. Now we're going to get some pushback going like, hey, you know, I don't like app assisted games. Is this music actually necessary? It would be like, hey, everybody vote on the coolest sounding song. No, it might be a thing where it is a victory point game. It is mechanistic, but ultimately it would be nice to sit here and like hear your song being played back and actually have it sound coherent, not just like, you know, a salad of weird notes that make no sense together. So I think it's possible if it were done that way. It would take something where I would need to work very closely with a very good, you know, app developer to make sure that everything worked out right and have enough, you know, backing from, you know, say a publisher to put behind that. I wouldn't go out of my way like I normally do.
Prototype on
spec and just do this. I'm not going to hire an app developer, just be like, hey, would you make this prototype for me? And then I'm going to go pitch it.
No.
It would need to be part of like a bigger project that got commissioned, I think.
So coming in Kickstarter 2024, JonnyPac and Seth Lefair Games is The Sounds of Gloomhaven.
You know what? It might happen. I know these guys.
Do you know what I mean? That's it. I just, as I say, I've just spoken to Ross Thompson not too long ago. I mean, I can email him and say, look, you're just doing your festival, and I'm listening to your festival. I ain't hearing no music. You have a big campaign, but all I'm hearing is the sound of change. And I'm not hearing the sound of kind of, you know, the Gloomhaven flute.
That's right. The vice president, Price Johnson, the vice president of Cliff O'Fair, is also kind of local to me. And he's actually been a singer in rock bands for as long as I know. He's got this really nice, like, high tenor voice. He does, you know, cover bands, all that kind of thing. So I think there's a sweet spot there. So maybe next episode, Price, like, hey, my man.
I think... we're on to something, and I think we should pitch it. You know, once obviously Coloma's funded and it's going to be there, but I mean, it sounds to me like we need to be kind of going on. Am I right in saying that you kind of put your head above the parapet and kind of said, okay, this is actually how much I've made as a board game designer in terms of money?
I've posted some stuff. So on Twitter, there's been this trend of designers kind of showing their earnings, and I'm not sure actually where that started, but you know, I'm fine with it. It was definitely enlightening to see some other designers going like, oh wow, you actually make money doing this. So because it feels like, you know, a lot of people's side hustle or something that they do just for the love of it. But then there are full-time designers. And then you've got your people who've made some mega hits. And you know, just by doing simple math, that they've made, you know, over $1 million off of one game alone if it goes really, really big like that. So the upward potential is there. But that joke when you get into game design, it's like, hey, when you make the next Monopoly, you know, don't forget about me. Send me a postcard. Ha ha. I'll say I know you went.
Yeah.
And then,
yeah,
you know, truth comes out to you and you tell them what kind of royalties they actually get and how much stuff has to sell and sell through and, you know, all this other end of it. And you just go, are you even making minimum wage? You go, not usually, for the amount of hours.
Exactly.
But the potential is there that, you know, if you do knock one out of the park, it will make up the difference, where it's like, you know, for the wingspans and gloomhaves and things like that, yeah, they're substantial. So as far as what I've done as a designer and a developer, they're kind of sometimes overlap and sometimes they don't. The developer tends to be something where I will do a flat fee particular project, or a small percent of a one-time small percent of a campaign, or an hourly thing if it's ongoing, to or a consultant thing where it's just like, hey, you know, X amount, you know, spend 1 hour, we sit down, look at it. That's one source of income. And I kind of got into that because the royalty games, it's very slow. So it's like, you think of a game, you design the game, you pitch the game, it goes into crowdfunding, it gets into production, it goes 6 months overseas, it goes into distribution, it sells, and then, you know, the company that is selling it pays out, you know, quarterly at best, sometimes yearly, you know, December 31st to get an invoice for something. So sometimes when you design a game, and by the time you get paid anything for it, contingent on it being successful, one of the weird little metaphors is like, sometimes that's a 2 or 3 year process. So if you thought about it in other things that take a number of years, you could think like sometimes the entire presidency in the United States will take that long, or somebody will meet somebody on Tinder, get married, have children. Those kids will learn to walk and talk by the time your game comes out and you get paid for it. So it makes you really learn to hold your breath for these long periods of time and become kind of agnostic about how much you're actually going to make on the back end of that thing, because you can't really know until it sells. And if it's just a one print run thing, you have to start over and start a new game. If it sells multiple print runs, you go, okay, this is going to have a longer tail on it and still maybe diminishing returns. And then you're always looking at, you know, are you going to get that big smash hit that's going to have some gonzo Kickstarter, and you get your chunk from the Kickstarter enough to carry over for the next, you know, however many years. Well, it gives you time to create your next crop of games or expansions in order to support that success.
Yeah, and I think one of the things I think that people forget is they go, oh, well, these designers are making lots and lots of money. They must be. And it's like, well, no, because the retail price, the retail price is like, normally the retail price is kind of like is there's a cost price in there. So the designer isn't even getting the whole retail price. In fact, they're usually not getting anything of the cost price. In fact, they're usually not getting a huge amount of that anyway. Mm-hmm. So even like on a slightly like a $60 game, you know, if they're going for retail and that game is like costing $40, then, you know, that's instantly then, and then it's saying, well, okay, it's 25 to manufacture, or it's 15 to manufacture, because we managed to do a 3,000 unit print run instead of a 1,000 unit print run, then, you know, that it's kind of economies of scale. So a designer can end up getting kind of next to very small per unit, which is sometimes it's a case you sign up for a kind of a fee. And being involved in getting more involved in a business point of view from kind of cost prices for games and how much they actually are. And it's like, I think there's people that run very, very successful dreams as opposed to people running very successful businesses. I think there's a lot of people that wash their face when they run a Kickstarter. I don't think there's many people that kind of run a very successful Kickstarter and then that's it, they're doing a career out of it. Kickstarter seems to be, you can get some people, I have seen businesses that have done like 6 figures on Kickstarter and they do one game and that's it. You never hear from them again. Because in the background, because they're great at the design side of things, but when it comes to the business side of things, it's like, we didn't realize it was all this business stuff to take care of. And then it's like, they've not gotten out afterwards. So it's like, yeah, I developed this Kickstarter, this game I developed for 6 years and it's out there and people are playing it. But I didn't know what I was meant to do once I successfully funded as well. And I think there's this misnomer that board game industry, because there's certain parts of it that make lots and lots of money, and there's certain companies that have like continual evergreen titles. I mean, we're talking about, I mean, you mentioned Wingspan, and it sold, was it almost, it must be almost like, I think it's about 1.6 million copies or something like that.
Yeah, but I think last I checked, it was 1.7, 1.8, something like that. Yeah. It's a lot.
But I don't think Red Rising sold that many copies, you know, as many copies. Right. I mean, I don't know if Scythe sold as many copies. So even somebody like, you know, Stonemaier Games, yes, they have Evergreen, and they've built up a catalogue, and they do have kind of like Evergreen games that will continue to sell. But I don't think it's like design a board game, stick it on Kickstarter, have a successful Kickstarter, and actually kind of sort it out. But I think there's a lot of people that kind of think that, and they think that Kickstarter people are made of money, which is a kind of strange situation to kind of be in. With you, I mean, Coloma is going to be out there, and the expansion is going to be out there, and people are going to kind of get their hands on it. Do you have like, have you got kind of like a 2-3 year plan of, right, this is the next game, this is the next game, this is the next game? Or are you one of these people that's kind of maybe developing 4 or 5 games at once and seeing which one is you're going to run with? Or do you have 8, 12?
Last time I checked.
There's a notebook, Jonny, in there.
Last time I checked, I was working on over 20 games, and I think I'm working on roughly 24 projects, game projects right now.
Wow.
In various stages. And some of those, if you unpack them, are pretty extensive, where it's like, yeah, I'm working on, say, Unconscious Mind right now. We're finishing development, mm-hmm. but I'm also working on the expansion. I'm also working on the solo mode. I'm also working on a whole bunch of modules and Kickstarter stuff that came out with it. And so in a sense, it's like that one game I'm building a solo mode for, which is kind of like designing its own game for that too. So it's a lot, yeah. Even in a single title like that, when they're content rich. And then there's other ones where, you know, air quotes, I'm still working on it, might be like Sweet Mess, where it's like, okay, well, the development and design part's done, but we're getting factory samples back to make sure that the vacuum trays fit properly and things like that. So there's some tails that I'm still working on that intermittently. As far as those go, so, you know, counting things like that. So if we looked at in various stages all the way down to we just shook hands or signed a contract to start working on a commission piece, well, you know, there's preliminary work being done on that, but, you know, it's not taking up the majority of my days at this point. So across the spectrum, it's like, yeah, I'm working on over 20 games currently.
Mm-hmm.
As far as like highly focused stuff, it might be 3, 4, 5 games at once, and it tends to be the squeakiest wheel that's going to get the oil. So like Coloma content is like, yeah, I've been working really hard to make sure that the campaign stuff is ready, and then also rolling out stuff for the stretch goals, making sure that those work, and talking with, you know, Will the Hungry Gamer, make sure that the solo mode is going well and being tested, and that's all kind of coming together, and then doing some stuff that we'll be doing in post, which is making a really, you know, nice rule book, giving the graphics, you know, facelift, whatever it needs to kind of get done, right? So that one's a primary focus. Unconscious Mind is, with Fantasia, is a big focus right now, because we want to get that out to backers as soon as possible, but also make it the absolute best product we can. Then there's stuff that's kind of kicked way out in the future, where one cat that's been let out of the bag is that Fantasia got the rights to Wolfgang Cromer's Colosseum, which used to be a Days of Wonder game. It's one of my favorite games. I was really, really excited that the license was available. And so we get to do like a deluxe new version of that and make some little tweaks and modules and things for that. So it's cool to basically be emailing back and forth with him, and then getting some artwork from the Micho, who's doing the artwork, and Ian O'Toole's doing the art direction on that. And so kind of corresponding, like, hey, if we redesigned the map to be like this, is there enough room for the players Colosseums to expand this way and that way? And, you know, being very familiar with the gameplay myself, I'm able to look at, yes, this looks cool, but it also needs to be functional and find that medium ground. So intermittently, like, working on something like that is part of what I'm doing. And so am I the designer of that game? No, but I'm helping develop and be the glue between the designer and the graphic designer and the artist to make sure that the gameplay stuff still really resonates well. And then we've got people sourcing, you know, blinging it out. What can we add to make this really deluxe or make this as good as your version, which better? So just being involved in that project.
It's interesting that you mentioned Wolfgang Kramer, because, and the reason I kind of looked to the side there, and nobody, you can't, because this is audio. So everybody's going, this doesn't make any sense. But I looked to the side because I've got a copy of Big Boss.
Oh, yeah.
Wolfgang Kramer. Yeah. It's, you know, it's one of Funko Game Prospero Hall. It's one of their recent things. So I'm wondering if Wolfgang's just going about kind of saying, do you want a game? Do you want to work on this game? Do you want to work on this game? Do you want to, if it's kind of gone through a thing of I'm handing out all my IPs like sweeties to hungry children to see who wants to kind of catch them on. So are you getting, so is some of your stuff, are you kind of being, kind of working almost like as a consultant, a kind of a developer consultant for some of these companies as well? Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Especially for Fantasia at this point. I was doing it more freelance for a bunch of companies, helping out with like Elf Creek and Alley Cat Games and more stuff with Final Frontier and Duranda Games. So I was staying busy, you know, kind of spread with that, but I'm consolidating.
What stuff did you do for Alley Cat Games? Sorry.
Oh, so Alley Cat, I worked on Aboria, which was on Kickstarter last year. It's got that really cool, splashy, fantasy animal kind of artwork. It's really, really cool looking. And that's
beautiful,
the new designer.
Looking game.
I think so, yeah. And that's the new designer, Danny Garcia, who's also has a game coming out very soon from Board and Dice called Barcelona. It's a Euro game, looks really cool. And he's an upcoming designer from Spain. He's really, really good at what he does, and it's a pleasure to work with him.
Am I right in saying that they've got about three or four games across different places, all kind of in the fire? I think their name has gone from nowhere to all of a sudden kind of being
a little bit far and wide
at the moment.
He's got quite a few things signed, and I think it's one of those things, like once these all actually start coming out in stores and stuff, it's suddenly be like, where'd this guy come from? Because he's got just good games popping out, and he's had this back catalog. He works really quickly too, which is nice. I've seen him, you know, feed him an idea, and he comes back a couple days later, and it's really well fleshed out and all that. So he's just very, very dedicated to his craft, which is awesome.
I hate him already. it's like, there are people like there who could just say, right, okay, so I'll tell you what, it's this type of game. They go, yeah, well, you need to do this, 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 and you're just like, yeah, I hope you get to the top of the stairs and realize you aren't at the top of the stairs and you do that extra stomp step and everybody and somebody who's important to you in your life sees you and you're embarrassed forever doing this top stompy stop at the top of the step. So there you go.
I know that step.
I've done it myself. I've started like going out of rooms and going into other rooms and going, what am I in this room for? What am I tonight, right? Okay, I'm moving some games downstairs, right? And I must have gone upstairs like four times to bring down the same game, and I managed to bring down, do you know how many times I managed to bring the game down? None. It's still up there. I was going to bring Oath downstairs and unpack it and look at it and kind of organize it further and stuff like that. But no, I came down with like Indiana Jones Sands of Adventure and Excavation Earth and one of the Lord of the Rings games, and I've got Big Boss there as well, and I've not got Oath. Why have I not got Oath? Because I'm old, Jonny, you know, because you're lucky you're actually speaking to me tonight and I've got trousers on, and that's all I'm going to say to you, you know, and I've even had a coffee. It's absolutely ridiculous. Going back, let's do the circle. The circle is complete. What is the entrance fee for Coloma New Prospects? If you want to go ahead and back the project, how much is it going to cost you to get in the door? And if you don't know, I've got it right here. Well, you click. How much am I charging people for the games? I can tell you now that the Coloma Deluxe Edition, which is one physical copy of the Coloma Standard Edition with a deluxe upgrade pack with all the pickleball unlocked scratch goals, is $79, which is about, I don't know, £66 or something. If you want just the new Prospects expansion by the art by the Miko that we forget, because they do some stunning art, is $29. And if you want to go for the mother load pledge,
that's the one.
Just who came up with that? Was that you? Because it's absolutely shockingly bad. Terrible. Bad form. It is $159, which is roughly, with our exchange rate, it's roughly about $147.73. So there you go. Have I missed anything? I don't know if I have.
Well, that comes with Fistful Meeples and the Fistful Meeples expansion. So you're actually getting two games and two expansions and the big box and all the deluxe game tray stuff with that. So it's a lot of content.
And a cuddly toy and an espresso machine and Johnny's undying love as well. That comes with big. And his own, if you send him a message, he will send you a 5-minute ringtone using the jazz flute that you can add to your phone as well. So that's nice. I'm just adding in stuff that you have to do. Oh, you've got the Pioneer Pledge, which is a physical copy, a deluxe upgrade, and the Coloma New Prospects expansion, which is $108 or £100 roughly. And what we'll do is we'll make sure we put all these in. We'll put a link to the campaign. I'm not writing this all out. Oh my goodness, I'm lazy and stupid. We'll put a link to the campaign in the show notes so we've got notes to show. If people have listened along tonight, Johnny, and they've went, he sounds interesting. How do I find him? Where do you exist on the internet webs?
I've got JonnyPac.com, so JonnyPac.com. It's just got some design stuff. I'm on BGG, I'm an active user on there, so I'm always answering rules questions and things like that, or it can be geek mailed. I do have a Twitter account. I'm not a big fan of Twitter, and a lot of people aren't, but I have it there just for tweeting stuff about games, but I'll answer direct messages on there as well. So I'm pretty easy to get hold of. It's not hard, and I'm pretty responsive, so I usually get back to people within a day or two.
Awesome. And as I say, we'll put all the links in the show notes so that we've got notes to show. If you want to keep an eye on what we're up to, go to the internet webs and search for We're Not Wizards, and you'll find us in all these wonderful different places where they set up stuff on hosting, and then people come along and have fun and parties and stuff like that. We're posting stuff on BGG, so if you want to read our reviews, you can read them on BGG. If you're listening along tonight and you're listening along on Spotify, then please consider dropping us a rating or a review on Spotify. And if you are going to be giving us a rating or a review on Spotify, remember not to give us 10 stars because it makes me big-headed, but don't give me 1 star because it makes me cry. Give me something in the middle, like a 5, because it's average. I'm just a little bit average. But the person who's not been average tonight is rather wonderful, rather fantastic. He's the man of the hour. He's got the bass line. He's got your tempo. But most of all, he's got your new prospects. It's Mr. JonnyPac Cantin. Thank you for coming along, sir. It's been an absolute pleasure. There's only 2 more things to do. The first thing to do is to remember that we're many things, but we're not wizards. Are we wizards, Johnny?
No.
Are we wizards, Johnny? Mm-mm. You're definitely not. Definitely not. And the other thing is to say goodbye. So it's a goodbye from Johnny. Say goodbye, Johnny.
Bye.
And it's a goodbye from you. Remember, stay safe. Roll sixes. And make something awful. But also, get yourself onto some Coloma before it runs dry like the river. But until the next time, goodbye.
A wizard is never licked. Nor is he early. He arrives precisely when he means to.